So, good evening, all the attendees in India and across the globe. On behalf of NeoLife, the Oncology Division of RPG Life Sciences, I, Avinash Singh, along with Oncology BU Head Mr. Ajit Mule and Medical Head Dr. Mangesh Bhale Rao, we welcome all the attendees for today's exciting and informative webinar again on amyloidosis and undiagnosed silent killer. RPG Life Sciences is a part of RPG Group companies providing affordable and quality medicines across various specialties like oncology, nephrology, and urology, not only in India, but also across 44 countries throughout the globe. We also believe that continuous learning is a way forward in today's world. And for the same reason, once again, on your request, we have with us an honored and a renowned speaker, Dr. M.B. Agarwal. Sir is one of the highly respected hematologist and oncohematologist in India and throughout Asia, and it is a pleasure to have Sir once again with us today. Sir is presently the head of Department of Hematology at Bombay Hospital Institute of Medical Sciences in Mumbai. He is also involved as an honorary hematologist at Leelavati Hospital and Beach Candy Hospital, Mumbai. Also currently, Sir is the president of Mumbai Hematology Group and was previously associated as president of Indian Society of Hematology in 2010 and 2011. With his vast experience and expertise in this field, it would be interesting to understand his thought on such a complex topic once again, which can help a doctor across the India day-to-day practice. So without any further delay, I would like to invite Agarwal sir and would request him to please carry forward the session. Thank you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you so much and good evening to everybody. I am especially thankful to RPG for organizing this webinar this evening. I'd like to introduce Mumbai Hematology Group to you, which is a very active academic body. And I welcome you to this group. This group does a lot of academic activities, especially we do on Sundays pre-lunch webinars on behalf of the education cell of MHG. This is done on every Sunday at 11:30 a.m. for about 2 hours. It's oriented towards hematology, hemato-oncology and allied subjects. We discuss current affairs and futuristic views and basically targeting DM students, clinicians and academicians. I like to introduce the coming Sunday webinar to you, which is on kidney in myeloma. And the faculty for that particular event includes Dr. Pankaj Bhai Shah from Ahmedabad, Dr. Biju George from CMC Vellore, Dr. Chitra Madiwale, nephropathologist from Hinduja Hospital, Mumbai, Dr. Shaila Kupchandani, nephropathologist from Jaslok Hospital, Mumbai, Dr. Prashant Mehta, medical oncologist, Faridabad, Dr. Dattatre, medical oncologist from Hyderabad, and myself. I'd also like you to log in for a very important international webinar that we have 3 days later. That's on Saturday, this coming Saturday, 13th June at 6:30 p.m. The speaker is Dr. Manali Kamdar. She's clinical director of lymphoma services at University of Colorado Cancer Center in US. And she'll be speaking on very important subject of practice changing advances in lymphoma during last 1 year. All of you who are logging in today will get the details of how to register for these two, and then you can get on from there. We have a question box, and you are most welcome to put in your questions, which we will be discussing at the end. So throughout this webinar, you are most welcome to write your questions. So talking about amyloidosis, a silent killer. Amyloidosis is like a wolf. And it's a wolf in the sheep's clothing. And you have to be always beware of the wolf in sheep's clothing. Amyloidosis is not a disease, it's a group of disorders. In this disease, the protein fibrils accumulate in certain organs, disrupting the tissue architecture and impairing the function of that particular organ. The clinical manifestations of prognosis vary widely depending upon the type of the amyloid and the organ that is involved. These are these fibrils which accumulate in the tissues. The term amyloid was coined almost 200 years ago by Rudolf Virchow, who was a great physician from Germany. There are types and types of amyloidosis, almost about 27 to 28 types, and the number keep increasing. But the four which are important to a clinical hematologist or a clinician in general are these four. The AL amyloidosis, which is an acquired disease, which is the commonest of the amyloidosis, and in which the light chain of the immunoglobulin form the amyloid. Long ago when we were students, we were taught that AA amyloid is the commonest. And this is also an acquired amyloid, and it's a reactive amyloid. So those patients who have chronic infection and chronic inflammatory diseases, in today's world, say rheumatoid arthritis, in yesterday's world, tuberculosis, bronchiectasis, they can lead to the occurrence of AA amyloid. The data, authentic data which available from the Western world, this numerically is a rare entity. And then we have these two, what I call ATTR amyloid, where there is accumulation of transthyretin in both of them. This first one, ATTR wild type, was previously known as senile amyloidosis, occurring in aged people due to accumulation of wild type transthyretin. While the other one, which is called ATTR-M, M for mutated, is due to a genetic mutation in this particular protein, and therefore it's obviously hereditary, and that's relatively less common. It is said that gradually, as human beings are living for a longer and longer period, the senile ATTR wild type will take over the AL and account for majority of the patients in clinical practice. And the more you look for that, probably more you will find them. As far as today's webinar is concerned, I don't think we have enough time to discuss all of these, so we are going to stick to AL amyloidosis. So coming to AL amyloidosis, it is due to accumulation of the light chain. This is the commonest type of amyloid as of today. There's a deposition of the misfolded monoclonal light chain which are secreted from, and this is most important, what is put in red color. There's an extremely small malignant plasma cell clone. So in multiple myeloma, you have a large number of malignant plasma clone. And some of them develop secondary amyloidosis. Well, here we are talking about primary AL amyloidosis, where there is no underlying myeloma, but yes, there is a malignant plasma cell clone, which is so small that the bone marrow may not even show numerically any increase in plasma cells. So it's more of a functional disorder of this clonal malignant plasma cell rather than correlated with the number of plasma cells. This structure, the AL amyloid, is insoluble. It deposits in the tissues and interferes with its organ. And the commonest organ to be involved are kidney and heart, and of course there are other organs involved. This is what is called primary amyloidosis. It is not an uncommon disorder, though we do not know the exact incidence of it. Some figures are available from US, and it varies from 9 to 14 cases per million person year. It's a disease of elderly, and the incidence increases with age. So in your clinical practice, if somebody is 60s and 70s, watch out for amyloid. The median age of amyloid is 63. Under 35 years of age is just about 1 to 2% of amyloid patients that are seen. The slight male preponderance, 55%. It occurs cut across all the races, all geographical locations. But data from various ethnic groups is limited. This shows you the age structure of AL amyloidosis, a disease which takes off from 40 and the incidence starts decreasing at 80, and the peak is between 60 and 70. And the dark black bar is the males, and the gray is the female, male little outnumber the females. It's extremely important that early and accurate diagnosis of this disease is made. And this is a challenge even for hematologists who are quite acquainted with multiple myeloma as a disease entity. That's their day-to-day practice. Not only that, slowly the treatment that an hematologist gives to myeloma patient is getting safely and effectively applied to that of patients of AL amyloid. In fact, when we come to treatment, you realize that the treatment of AL amyloid today does not differ significantly from that of myeloma. Response to the treatment can be assessed objectively. Again, when we were students, you had to do the organ biopsy. Not do that. You can assess the response to treatment by various biomarkers. And gradually, even the prognosis of this entity is improving. To diagnose this entity, you have to be virtually like Sherlock Holmes. I'm going to show you two cases. So my first case is from Lucknow. An aged man, first seen about 5 years ago in January 2015 for sciatica. And at that time, the workup gave an incidental diagnosis of monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance of lambda type. And as you see, free light chain lambda was a bit raised. Almost 2 years later, he complained of breathlessness and fatigue. ECG showed increased left ventricular wall thickness. Cardiac MRI showed that there was an infiltrative cardiomyopathy and therefore amyloid was suspected. As one would do, abdominal fat pad aspiration biopsy was done. It was negative. It was repeated. It was again negative. Fortunately, urine showed proteinuria and it was in nephrotic range, 3.1 grams in 24 hours. And therefore, kidney biopsy got done. And that picked up the light chain amyloid deposit in the vascular tissue. Retrospectively, this diagnosis could have been made 2 years earlier. But because his M-band was stable and because there was no increase in plasma cells in the marrow, no one thought of it. Abdominal fat aspiration is usually a reasonably good test to pick up amyloid, but it has a sensitivity of 70%. That means 30% of patients could have a negative abdominal fat pad aspirate. Also, this test is operator-dependent test. One has to master the technique of doing this. In our institute, a single surgeon has been doing it for the last 30 years. This delay of 2 years, which our friend from Lucknow faced, finally became detrimental to his outcome. And that's why I call amyloidosis as a silent killer. Let me move on to the second patient. My second case is from Bengaluru, again seen about 4 years ago. He already had a history of 1 year duration of orthostatic hypotension, diarrhea, fatigue, and loss of weight of 18 kg. Subsequently, in March, after about 1.5 years, he developed urinary retention. And urologist at the end of the workup showed that he will require self-catheterization on a regular basis. Another 6 months later, in October 2017, a neurologist saw him for so-called CIDP and treated him with intravenous IVIG and plasma exchange. February 18, he was found to have a mass in the left kidney. It was biopsied. He bled from that biopsy site, requiring embolization and 13 units of PET cell. A little later in July, for persistent diarrhea, he underwent a colonoscopy and colonoscopic biopsy, and that picked up amyloid. And then the detailed workup showed that this was AL amyloid. So our friend, who now was diagnosed of AL amyloid in 2018, had first presented in 2015 with amyloid-induced autonomic neuropathy causing orthostatic hypotension, diarrhea, and autonomic bladder. And that's why amyloidosis is a silent killer. This case has been published in literature where AL amyloid presented as scleroderma. And these three pictures belong to that gentleman. He could not squat because of the skin tightness. He could not open his mouth because of the skin tightness. He could not protrude his tongue because of the skin tightness. Classical of so-called scleroderma. But then the biopsy showed this wasn't scleroderma, it was amyloid. another case presentation published, fatal refractory cardiac arrest as a presenting feature of systemic amyloid diagnosed on autopsy. One would hardly ever think a sudden cardiac arrest must be coronary heart disease, but here it is, something different. Let's now discuss the clinical picture of amyloidosis. So, clinical picture of amyloidosis, symptoms are non-specific. They do not give you a clue that the patient may have amyloidosis. Weight loss, fatigue, edema, exertional breathlessness, all non-specific. In fact, weight loss of amyloid is unrelated to GI problem. In fact, the mechanism of this weight loss even today is a mystery. Some of the amyloid patients may have soft tissue deposits, and that could give you a clinical suspicion, but this occurs only in 15% of patients. Other manifestations could be lightheadedness and orthostatic syncope. These are common, and these are common because there is a reduced intravascular volume, which in turn is due to hypoalbuminemia, use of diuretics, and above all, autonomic neuropathy. In some patients, a single organ is affected, while in others, multiple organs may be affected. So clinical picture would vary. It would depend upon how many organs are involved, which organ is involved, and what is the extent of organ involvement. If you want me to tell you the frequency of involvement of various organs in AL amyloid, heart 75%, kidney 65%, liver 15%, neurology 15%, GI tract 10%, and hemostatic or coagulation cascade in 10%. Same data, heart highest, kidney next, soft tissue, tumors, liver, peripheral nervous system, and autonomic nervous system. Let's see something, what happens to the heart. So look at the cardiac wall, the ventricular wall and the interventricular septum, how thickened they are. The cavity is reduced. There is no cardiomegaly. Here, cavity is hardly there. It's all thickened wall. Same, another patient, interventricular wall, ventricular wall. This is intersurface of the atria, giving a waxy look due to amyloid deposition. So overall, heart is involved in 75% of patients. Cardiac involvement is there or not there, ultimately decides the prognosis. Cardiac involvement results into fatigue, exertional breathlessness, peripheral edema, JVP, and even hydrothorax. It can lead to arrhythmias, which can cause sudden death or syncope. And rarely, even myocardial infarction can occur because of amyloid in the coronaries. Endomyocardial biopsy, again, when I was a student, was considered as a gold standard, but it is no more done. Today, you have biomarkers of cardiac involvement in the form of NT-proBNP and TROP-T. Even ECG could give you some clue because it will be low voltage. There may be pseudo-infarct pattern because of poor R-wave progression, and there may be atrial fibrillation. Echocardiography must be done in all patients, and it's quite characteristic. It's a disease of diastole. ECHO will show you thickening of the left ventricular wall, interventricular septum, reduced strain, and preserved ejection fraction. Atrial thrombi occur even when the patient is in sinus rhythm. And once atrial fibrillation sets in, there is a rapid deterioration. Patients who have cardiac involvement have an increased risk of thromboembolism. What about imaging? You can do cardiac imaging, and it's very, very useful. So cardiac MRI, late gadolinium enhancement, is a highly sensitive and a reasonably specific test. The negative part about MRI of the heart is that it cannot subtype the amyloid. It cannot tell you whether it is AL or AA or ATTR. For that, you require a technician scan. Technetium scan is widely available, and this can identify ATTR subtype. These are three pictures. The left one is MRI of the heart, the middle one is PET scan, and the right one is MRI and the PET scan superimposed. Moving from heart to kidney, look at this enlarged waxy kidney. Kidney is involved in 65% of cases, just next to heart. It manifests as peripheral edema or anasarca. Urine may be foamy and there may be symptoms of uremia. Urine will show you non-selective proteinuria or proteinuria in nephrotic range. There will be hyperlipidemia, dyslipidemia, hypoalbuminemia, and non-selective proteinuria. If you do imaging, sonography, or CT scan, the kidneys are enlarged. Coming to the GI tract. So this is a biopsy of the intestine, small bowel, and as you see, submucosa. The blood vessels show you Congo red positive eosinophilic material. The GI tract involvement leads to gastroparesis, and this manifests as constipation or diarrhea, early satiety, heartburn. It can result into loss of weight. There can be nausea, vomiting, can even lead to GI bleeding. This is a publication of a case report where stomach and duodenum were the cause of clinical symptoms, and the disease affecting stomach and duodenum was AL amyloid. And that's another case where patient presented with abdominal bloating due to, again, intestinal amyloid. Coming to the liver, there may be hepatomegaly, alkaline phosphatase may be raised, and factor 10 deficiency may set in. This is liver on the left side due to amyloid, and you see three pictures. This is light microscopy, that is Congo red, and that is fluorescent, showing you light apple green fluorescence. Soft tissue involvement can lead to macroglossia, hoarseness of voice, dysarthria, obstructive sleep apnea, periorbital purpura, submandibular gland swelling, xerostomia, the shoulder pad sign, which is famous, and the carpal tunnel syndrome. Now, this is macroglossia. You can see the dental indentation. This is even more gross, macroglossia, and you see the dental indentation. And this is a very large tongue, which cannot be accommodated in the oral cavity, and the deep dental indentations. And that's the famous shoulder pad sign, due to soft tissue accumulation of amyloid around the shoulder. This is also shoulder pad sign. This is cutaneous or subcutaneous deposition of amyloid tissue. You see a tumor-like situation or a plaque which is raised on the sole of the feet. This is periorbital accumulation of amyloid leading to what is called raccoon eyes. Look at these eyes, look at this darkening, look at this darkening, and look at this different color in the center. This is called raccoon eyes because of this animal called raccoon. This animal is not there in India, it is found in South America. And you look at this periorbital pigmentation and you look at this central pigmentation. And that's why you call this raccoon eyes. Another example of amyloid deposition in the periorbital tissue. Another example of amyloid deposition in the periorbital tissue. This is lacrimal gland enlargement due to amyloid in the lacrimal gland. Coming to the neurology, so there can be peripheral neuropathy in 15%. EMG can be normal because this is the involvement of small unmyelinated nerve fibers. Similar number of patients develop autonomic neuropathy, and this can lead to bladder bowel dysfunction, like our patient had diarrhea and urinary retention. Autonomic neuropathy also leads to orthostatic hypotension, syncope, and it can, carpal tunnel manifestation could be another neurological manifestation of amyloid. So this is a patient with peripheral neuropathy, and this was a patient with carpal tunnel syndrome. This is microscopic structure showing you severe axonal loss due to amyloid neuropathy. And that's a sural nerve biopsy. And that's another sural nerve biopsy showing you this time Congo red stained by arrow. And that's nerve biopsy showing you everything, the routine stain, the Congo red, and the fluorescence. Hemostatic abnormalities are chiefly due to factor 10 deficiency. Overall, bleeding diathesis occur in 10%, but abnormal coagulation tests occur in 30%. Factor 10 deficiency is not the sole cause of all this, but is a common cause of this. And factor 10 deficiency is due to three mechanisms. Factor 10 gets lost in the amyloid fibril, it binds to it. There may be decreased synthesis due to amyloid liver, and there can be acquired von Willebrand disease. Some patients bleed without any coagulation abnormalities, and this is due to amyloid infiltration of the blood vessel. A liver biopsy can lead to torrential hemorrhage. And if you remember, our second patient had a kidney biopsy, and what happened to him? He needed 13 units of blood transfusion and embolization of the blood vessel. This is subconjunctival hemorrhage and the periorbital hemorrhage due to amyloid leading to factor 10 deficiency. And that's extensive cutaneous bruising between the breast, on the breast, due to amyloid purpura. And that's amyloid deposition in the blood vessel. And this can lead to hemorrhage without any detectable coagulation abnormalities. Okay, so we have seen the clinical picture of amyloid. Now let's come to how do you diagnose amyloid objectively. So, to diagnose amyloid, you have to document amyloid. And this documentation of amyloid has to be in a tissue sample. So like you diagnose cancer by biopsy, amyloid has to be diagnosed by a biopsy. What do you biopsy? So if an important organ is involved, there's a manifestation of that, then you go for that organ. So you may do kidney biopsy, you may do endomyocardial biopsy, you can do liver biopsy. All these three things are done less commonly today. Again, when I was a student, rectal biopsy was very popular. Salivary gland biopsy was very popular. But what is popular today is abdominal fat pad and the bone marrow biopsy. And you almost don't do this in almost about 70 to 80% of patients where you can make a diagnosis by abdominal fat pad aspiration and bone marrow trephine biopsy. So look at the sensitivity. Abdominal fat pad aspiration biopsy, 70%. Rectal biopsy, 60%, bone marrow, 50%. So abdominal fat pad biopsy and bone marrow biopsy together can give you a good yield of diagnosis. And then if there is an involvement, you can do skin biopsy, kidney, liver. Before I leave the subject of biopsy, I may tell you that the liver biopsy is avoided because it can lead to fatal hemorrhage as the blood vessels may not shrink at all. Blood investigations in a patient of amyloid will include blood counts, liver and kidney function, serum protein electrophoresis a must, serum protein immunofixation a must, serum free light chain assay absolutely must. Then to look at the heart, NT-proBNP and TROPT, thyroid and the coagulation. In systemic amyloidosis, there's a very important role of biomarkers. And the two important biomarkers are NT-proBNP, a diagnostic test, a prognostic test, and a test which helps you to follow up the patient. And TROPT, again a diagnostic test, a prognostic test, and a test which you can follow up for response to treatment. This is immunofixation, serum protein immunofixation. What you see here is lambda monoclonal gammopathy. So you may have pure light chain, you may have IgG lambda, IgA lambda, or IgM lambda, so intact monoclonal immunoglobulin. And in small percentage of patients, you may have even kappa, though lambda accounts for almost 80%, kappa for about 20%. Serum free light chain assay is a very, very helpful diagnostic test. It must never be skipped whenever you have an unexplained clinical problem. See, biopsies cannot be ordered easily. But your unexplained fatigue, unexplained weight loss, unexplained orthostatic hypotension, unexplained hepatomegaly, unexplained proteinuria, all these patients you can do this blood test, serum free light chain assay. So in amyloidosis, the free light chain are circulating in the blood, kappa or lambda. And one of them is increased, which gives you specificity of monoclonality, and that can be clinching for a monoclonal gammopathy, one of the important causes amyloid. Not only that, the FLC, the free light chain subtype, is related to the type of organ involved. For example, if it is kappa, which is rare, it speaks of GI tract and the liver involvement, and if it's lambda, it is more of kidney involvement. Prognosis of both kappa and lambda is identical. Urine tests you do routine, 24-hour urine protein quantitation and urine protein electrophoresis. And there are patients whom you didn't pick up in the serum, you pick up in the urine. Organ-specific tests will be ECG, ECHO, MRI, we talked about it, EMG, nerve conduction, to look at the neurology, bone marrow, not only biopsy, but also cytogenetics. You do molecular cytogenetics by FISH and specific organ biopsies. So this is a technique of abdominal fat pad aspiration biopsy. I can't go into the technology of it, I'm not a surgeon, but my surgeon colleague who does it has published his experience very beautifully. And according to him, the yield can be almost 80 to 90% if the procedure is carried out correctly. Congo red stain. When you talk of amyloid, you have to talk of Congo red stain. So Sigma originally marketed this stain, which was red in color, so red. And those days, the Europeans were fighting to acquire as much of Congo, which is a country in Africa, under their domain, because it was a very rich source of minerals. So hot was the word Congo that Sigma felt that they should call this dye as Congo red dye. What is this? This is kidney biopsy showing you this waxy amyloid material under HE stain. And this is Congo red looked under fluorescent microscope using a Texas red filter. And that's under the polarized light. You can see the beautiful apple green birefringence. And that's kidney biopsy in toto. HE stain, Congo red stain, Congo red stain again, fluorescence, apple green, fluorescence, and this is electron microscopic structure. Heart, thickening and the Congo red. And that's myocardium. That's Congo red, heart. That's under polarized light, heart. That's everything together, HE stain, Congo red, and fluorescent under polarized light. Now what is this? This is plasma cell in the bone marrow. Numerically not increased. Morphologically not abnormal. But the source of AL amyloid. What causes AL amyloid is this misdeeds of this plasma cell in the bone marrow. This is amyloid in the bone marrow. So this is bone marrow trephine biopsy and a blood vessel is showing you Congo red positive amyloid stain. And that's under the polarized light showing you the refringence, green apple. Okay. Now I told you about the FISH study in bone marrow. What it shows? Very interestingly, in myeloma, 1.5% show 11-14 translocation. In amyloid, every alternate patient has got 11-14 translocation. And those of you who are hematologists or doing DM hematology, or hemato-oncology or medical oncology, you remember there's a drug called venetoclax which works on 11-14 translocation. We'll come to that later. In myeloma, you have monosomy 13 or deletion of long arm of 13. Here, 1/3 of the patient have this in amyloid. In myeloma, you have trisomies. Here, 1/4 of the patient have trisomies. So 1/4 trisomies, 1/3 monosomies, and every alternate patient 11-14 translocation. Okay, so you have seen the clinical picture of amyloid and you have seen how to look at amyloid by doing organ biopsy and how it looks under HE stain, how it looks under with the Congo red staining and how it looks under polarized light and how also it looks under electron microscopy. Having documented amyloid, is it equal to AL amyloid? The answer is no. If you have documented amyloid and if you documented a light chain monoclonal gammopathy, Can you say that this is now AL amyloid? The answer is once again no. 65-year-old man, which is a classical type of patient who has amyloidosis, will be considered an elderly man. And elderly people have monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance to the tune of anywhere from 1% to 3% to 7% to almost 10%, depending upon your 50, 60, 70, 80 or 90 year old. So you can have A amyloid or ATTR amyloid, and there may be incidental finding of amyloid. And because there was a monoclonal gammopathy, you may be tempted to call all these amyloid as AL amyloid. And even treat like AL amyloid with chemotherapy. A gross error of judgment and gross wrong treatment, which is not only ineffective, but also can be fatal. So a combination of MGUS of old people with AA or ATTR amyloid can be mistakenly diagnosed as AL amyloid. And that's why in every patient of amyloid, even in the presence of MGUS, you need to do objective test to know whether it is AL, AA or ATTR. This is a publication in the prestigious New England Journal. Misdiagnosis of hereditary amyloidosis as AL amyloidosis. So what I told is not theoretical, it's published. And this is monoclonal gammopathy plus positive amyloid biopsy is not equal to AL amyloid. And who has published this? Angela Dispenjeri. Again in hematology community, very well respected name from Mayo Clinic. She has spent her life, 40 years, working on monoclonal proteins. So, having created all the confusion, how do you finally find out that the amyloid is what type? AL, AA, ATTR? So immunohistochemistry comes in the picture. So to ask your, you know, I mentioned to you about the next Sunday we have a webinar and we have two nephropathologists. So this is the job of now nephropathologist. It's she who does the specific immunohistochemistry using antibody against light chain, antibodies against AA protein, apolipoprotein, or antibody against ATTR protein, and tells you objectively that IHC has shown AL or AA or ATTR. This test is widely available, widely used and sensitive, but it is not very specific. So what is more specific than this? More specific than this is immunoelectromicroscopy, IEM, using gold labeled antibodies, which is of course sensitive but also specific. The problem is that immunoelectron microscopy is not available left and right. We in Mumbai are very lucky. Again, the pathologist I have told you, Shaila Khubchandani, she is the head of the Department of Electron Microscopy in Jasbagh Hospital, and we have this test available to us. Well, what is best to know the type of amyloid and what is not available anywhere in India at the moment is mass spectrometry. Laser micro dissection and mass spectrometry based proteomic analysis on paraffin embedded biopsy is the way to go. So what we do, we send this paraffin embedded biopsies of kidney or abdominal fat or bone marrow biopsy or whatever to centers, the amyloid centers in the world, UK and USA, and let them tell us what the mass spectrometry has shown us. So this is the gold standard test for subtyping. It has 100% specificity and 90% sensitivity. Availability is an issue. So there's a journal of mass spectrometry. Mass spectrometry is not only for amyloid, and it's not only for medical people. So there's a journal dedicated to this, published by Willy. That's one of the ancient mass spectrometry, and this is one of the modern. And I put this red box on two points. The electron gun. Here the electron gun leads to the ionization of the protein, which is allowed to flow from here. And this is magnetic ion, again in the box. What it does is the ion's path bends under this magnetic force and then there is detector. So this is the, you can call it ultrastructure of the mass spectrometer. If you are in London, you have one more test available to you. In the whole world, it's available only in London. And only in one institute in London, Royal Free Hospital. It's called SAP scan. S-A-P. Serum amyloid P component. So amyloid has a P component. And what these guys have done, they have produced a SAP scan. Now, why only London? Why only UK? Why not USA? Because this requires handling of animal protein. And that's not considered safe because you have to inject this into the human body. So it's not considered safe because it could be a source of pathogen. So the American FDA did not license it. Anyway, it's a wonderful test. So Royal Free Hospital, it visualizes and quantifies the amyloid. So that's most important. You do it at the baseline, you do it after your treatment, and you do it at the time of relapse. And it will tell you that the treatment is working or the disease is relapsing. So it's a quantitative test. And it can tell you the amyloid quantity in kidney, liver, spleen, adrenal, bones. It can be positive even when the biopsies are negative. Wonderful, isn't it? So it gives you response to treatment because it is a quantitative test. Everything has a negative point. So besides it uses animal protein, the other point is that it cannot detect somehow cardiac involvement by amyloid. So if you are looking at the heart, which is so important, SAP is not the way to go. This is the equipment, a big use equipment. And that's an example of a patient followed up for 6 years. 2005, SAP scan positive in liver and spleen. See the massive amount of amyloid deposition. And then after the treatment, after 4 years later, look at the marked clearance of the amyloid in the liver and the spleen. And then in 2011, relapse of the disease increased not only in liver and spleen, but also now in kidney, which was hardly there before. So this is the importance of SAP scan. If you remember in the beginning, I told you three acquired amyloidosis and one genetic amyloidosis. AL, AA and ATTR senile were the acquired ones. And the ATTR M was the mutated one. Now that's very important. That's important in certain part of the world. For example, Portugal. There were extremely high incidence of this mutation. So should you do the mutation test, say in India, when the disease is uncommon? You should do it in two situations. One, when your patient of so-called amyloidosis has no evidence of plasma cell dyscrasia. There is no M protein in the blood or urine, and there is no abnormality in the serum free light chain assay. The plasma cells in the marrow are not increased. So then this becomes a suspicious patient. This cannot be straight away labeled as AL amyloid. Or there is a familial amyloid. So brother and brother, or son and father, son or mother. So if there are more than one member involved with amyloid, you have to think of the genetic entity. And therefore you do the genetic test. Genetic tests are expensive, so you do it carefully. We have International Myeloma Working Group, IMWG. Again, those who are hematologists or hematologist students know about it with respect to myeloma. Everything in myeloma is stamped by them as far as the guidelines and recommendations are concerned. So they also have diagnostic criteria for amyloid. They have put four groups of requirement, and all four groups have to be positive to, at least for the research purpose and maybe even in the clinical practice. So you have amyloid related systemic syndromes. So clinical picture of kidney, heart, liver, GI or nerve involvement. So clinical picture, first requirement. Second requirement is you got to show that there is a Congo red positive material deposited in one of the tissue. Abdominal fat pad, bone marrow, organ biopsy, whatever. So clinical picture followed by Congo red positive. Third is to document a monoclonal plasma cell disease. If you are talking about AL amyloid, then this is mandatory. There are occasional patients where this can be normal. But by and large, this has to be documented. And lastly, the type of amyloid. to be documented by either, let us see, in Indian situation, immunohistochemistry, if you are in Mumbai, immunoelectron microscopy, and if you are sending your tissue outside, mass spectrometry. So according to the working group, all these four are there, then your patient is a pakka case of AL amyloidosis. With an entity called localized amyloidosis. That's very different. And I'm discussing this as a differential diagnosis rather than, I'm not going to go in depth of localized amyloidosis. This is amyloid of an organ. So just last week we had an amyloid of the thyroid. There's no evidence of systemic amyloidosis. There's no evidence of plasma cell dyscrasia. This is not plasmacytoma of thyroid. Because in plasmacytoma, it will be full of plasma cells and there's a little amyloid. This was lot of amyloid with hardly any plasma cells. So this can be easily distinguished. It can lead to severe destruction of that local tissue. For example, this lady I'm talking about had TSH, which was more than 200. Thyroid was already totally destroyed. But it is not a cancer. It's a benign disease. Treatment is surgery, or sometimes laser-based surgery, or if it is at a site which cannot be operated upon, then radiotherapy. This is a publication of rare amyloidoma of tongue base, and I'll show you the picture. This is that yellowish waxy amyloidoma of tongue base. This is amyloidoma of the skin, cutaneous tumor on biopsy or amyloid. So having seen diagnosis, we come to now prognosis. How do you prognosticate? A case of amyloid may die in 6 months and the second one may be alive after 10 years. So heart. Simplest is to look at the heart. Heart is not involved, prognosis is excellent. Heart is involved, prognosis is bad. How do you look at the heart? You do what is called HSCT&T, high sensitivity cardiac trop T. You do trop I, and you do NT-proBNP, so biomarkers. Not only they give you idea about the cardiac involvement, they also tell you the intensity of cardiac involvement and you can follow it up with the treatment. Another importance of TROP-T, if TROP-T is high, autologous stem cell transplant related mortality is high. So you got to have a good heart to undergo autologous transplant. If after follow-up, the NT-proBNP, and another test is free light chain assay. After 3 months, repeat test, if they become normal or they respond beautifully, then the survival will be longest. So that's prognosis by biomarkers. One of the biomarkers used over here is a part of revised myoclonic staging system. So your patient can be staged and the stage tells you the prognosis. What are you looking at? You are looking at DFLC. And what is DFLC? DFLC is involved free light chain, say lambda minus uninvolved free light chain, kappa. And this difference of lambda minus kappa, if it is more than 18, it's bad. CTNT, NT-proBNP, and these are the figures. So you can have a score of 0, 1, 2, or 3. Depending on the stage 1, 2, 3, 4. Stage 1, median survival 94 months. And stage 4, median survival 6 months. So doing biomarkers, FLC and proBNP, anti-proBNP is enough to tell you 6 months versus 94 months. If your marrow has a plasma cell of more than 10%, then their prognosis is more like myeloma than amyloidosis. So they may get bone disease, they may get less of heart. If it was amyloid, there will be very hardly any bone disease, there will be a lot of heart. Now this is NT-proBNP and New York Heart Association class with respect to the symptomatology of heart. So this becomes the worst, their NT-proBNP and NYHA4. Well, this is the best when NT-proBNP is hardly elevated and it is NYHA1. So this tells you how NT-proBNP gives you survival. If it is low, survival is better. If it is high, survival is better. This tells you about DFLC. If DFLC is low, survival is better. DFLC is high, survival is poor. Immunoparesis has a negative impact on response and survival. What is immunoparesis? Low normal immunoglobulin. So you've got IgG lambda disease, then IgA and IgM. If they are low, then that person has a poor prognosis with compared to those who have got a normal level of normal immunoglobulins. Renal biopsy can give you prognosis. So you did it for diagnosis. It can give you prognosis by looking at CSIS, that is composite scarring injury score, and AS, that is amyloid score. If your amyloid score is high, then these patients have very high chance of end-stage kidney disease. Now, prognosis as per response to treatment. So, if there is, first of all, how much is the time taken for the organ response? Liver, 5 months. Kidney, 6 months. Heart is the last 9.5 months. It takes that much time for the response to be visible. Now, depending upon this, we will discuss this, but depending on the depth of organ response, the survival will be better and better. So, complete organ response is the nadir anti-proBNP is less than 400. Nadir proteinuria is less than 200. Nadir alkaline phosphatase is less than 2, the upper limit of normal. Very good partial response, VGPR, as we say in myeloma, more than 60% reduction. Partial PR, 30 to 60% reduction. And if it is less than 30%, it will be considered no organ response. I come to the most important part, which all of you who are clinicians must be waiting for, managing amyloidosis. How do you manage amyloidosis? So treating amyloid is a team approach. You need a hematologist, cardiologist, nephrologist, gastroenterologist, and neurologist, depending upon the type of organ involvement. Unfortunately, there are very few prospective randomized phase 3 studies to tell you. So all our recommendations are based on phase 2 study, retrospective study, and case series. First and the most important is the supportive care. So those who have got heart and kidney invariably need diuretics, which takes care of the anasarca, but can lead to hypotension and can lead to increase in creatinine. You should very carefully keep looking at the weight, blood pressure, creatinine level, and potassium. Those who develop significant hypotension may benefit from midodrine. Nutrition. Nutritional evaluation is an integral part of AL amyloid patient. We involve the nutritionist because malnutrition at diagnosis predicts mortality. And this is independent of the heart involvement and independent of the response to treatment. Prophylaxis against infection. AL amyloid patients are prone to infection like myeloma because they are losing immunoglobulin and we are going to give them immunosuppressive drugs. So prophylactic vaccination is done for all, which includes both types of pneumococcal vaccine, H influenza vaccines every year. There may be some role of giving intravenous gamma globulin if there is frequent clinical infections of so significant the patient needs hospitalization. And prophylactic antimicrobials. They are not in general prescribed, but there are people who will use antimicrobials against viruses, against PJP, against fungal infection regularly. Now we talked about atrial fibrillation in these patients. So atrial fibrillation is common. Digoxin was considered as a contraindicated drug because of the assumption that amyloid fibrils bind the digoxin. However, recent data has shown that low-dose digoxin can be used, provided you have facility for drug level and you closely monitor the electrolyte and kidney status. ACE inhibitors are poorly tolerated because of occurrence of hypotension, and therefore they should be used in the lowest tolerable dose. ICD, its efficacy has not been demonstrated prospectively. Mayo Clinic looked at 33 patients who received ICD. There was a high rate of appropriate ICD shock, but this did not translate into overall survival. Bradyarrhythmias, they proceed terminal cardiac decompensation in many patients with severe cardiac amyloid. A study of newly diagnosed patient with severe symptomatic cardiac amyloid, pacemaker insertion failed to salvage patients with bradyarrhythmia. After all the general discussion, we come to the specific treatment. And specific treatment, it reads like as if you're talking about myeloma. So you got anti-plasma cell therapy. What was responsible for amyloidosis, AL amyloidosis? That one mutated plasma cell, which numerically was not much, but was producing these light chains, which were amyloidogenic. So what do you use? Alkylating agents, corticosteroids, proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory agents, monoclonal antibodies, and above all, venetoclax, which is anti-BCL2. This is the timeline of drug development in the chapter of amyloidosis. So again, back to when I was a student, it was melphalan. Then came autologous transplant. Then came IMIDs, thalidomide, lenalidomide. That came PIs, bortezomib. Then third generation IMID, pomalidomide. And today, we have monoclonals. We have second generation PIs, the BCL2 inhibitor, and we have newer alkylating agent. So we are very rich in our drug armamentarium for treating AL amyloid. The problem is you should diagnose it early. So there are old drugs, there are new drugs, and sometimes old is gold. Melphalan, the oldest drug in the treatment of amyloidosis, in my mind is still the gold. So major goal of therapy is to destroy the amyloidogenic clone, which is secreting the toxic light chain, and to achieve deep response, which will result into improved overall survival. And melphalan prednisolone is still a reasonable option. And today, I practice in Dadar. On one side of me is Dharavi slum. The patient comes from there. My treatment is still melphalan corticosteroids, and many, many of them live for years. So combination of melphalan, prednisolone and colchicine is an ancient treatment, and it was shown to be superior to colchicine alone in 1970s and 80s. These were the curves. This is colchicine alone. This is melphalan prednisolone. This is melphalan prednisolone plus colchicine. Colchicine made no big difference, so melphalan prednisolone was the standard of care. An Italian group showed that oral melphalan with dex, which is probably superior to prednisolone in its efficacy, in patients who were ineligible for autologous transplant, 2/3 achieved response, 1/3 achieved complete response. And this happened within 4 to 5 months. And look at this. The progression-free survival was almost 4 years, and overall survival was, median was 5 years. For a disease like amyloid, with the cheapest simple treatment, melphalan and steroid, this is not bad. Unfortunately, melphalan is a bad drug because it causes myelodysplasia. So if you use it over and over again and again, 18% of patients can develop myelodysplasia at 10 years, which is a fatal disease. So today we don't use melphalan for more than 1 year, because you've got even safer alkylating agents like cyclophosphamide and bendamustine. So bendamustine. So this is a publication in Blood, I think this year, no, 2018. Treatment of AL amyloid, a study of good number, 122 patients. This is an Italian, German, European study. So these are guys from Italy, this is from Germany. What they concluded? Bendamustine is a valuable rescue therapy for AL amyloidosis. It is able to improve the survival in responders, even in heavily pre-treated patients. And amyloid in patient with IgM, monoclonal gammopathy, given with rituximab, bendamustine given with rituximab is an interesting outcome. Proteasome inhibitors, well, bortezomib is the classical one. So bortezomib with dex, bortezomib with prednisolone melphalan, and our friend Cyborg D, which is quite popular, bortezomib, cyclophosphamide, and dexamethasone. Wherever patient's condition permits, dexamethasone is preferred today over prednisolone. Cyclophosphamide is preferred over melphalan, and bortezomib, of course, is the PI. You have second generation, carfilzomib, but it's a bit risky because this is cardiotoxic. And amyloid is cardiotoxic drug. So in multiple myeloma where heart is not involved, carfilzomib is wonderful. In amyloid where heart is invariably involved, you have to be very careful while using carfilzomib. And surprise of all is the oral ixazomib, the oral PI. It has shown remarkable activity and remarkable safety in patients with amyloid, something which you didn't see in myeloma. So today the world is talking about ixazomib, which is oral, and oral combination therapy, total oral combination therapy. So much so the FDA gave a breakthrough designation to ixazomib 6 years ago. Unfortunately, the drug is not yet available in India. RPG should bring it. Ixazomib with dex, ixazomib cyclophosphamide with dex, ixazomib with len and dex, and followed by ixazomib maintenance, because it's an oral drug. Once a week, you can use it in maintenance. Not only it helps amyloid, it can reverse the cardiac and kidney dysfunction. Therefore, it's a miracle, a surprising, because this was not expected out of ixazomib. So ixazomib has made all oral therapy possible. And this is that all oral therapy. Ixazomib with len, with dex. Oral. Published in British Journal of Hematology. A powerful oral triplet for AL amyloid. In the era of proteasome inhibitor, if you look at 50 months, that is more than 4 years, we've got 50% survival beyond 4 years. Coming to the IMiDs, the three IMiDs, thalidomide, lenalidomide, pomalidomide. Thalidomide is not popular because it adds to the peripheral neuropathy of amyloid. Len is more popular, but you have to be careful because it has got certain cardiac toxicity. And therefore, pomalidomide has gradually becoming the preferred IMiD. But the data on this third generation IMiD is limited. This is the data on pomalidomide, overall survival, progression-free survival. These are all relapsed patients. This is from Dr. Vaishali from Boston Clinic. Long-term outcome of patients treated with immunomodulatory agents. Moving on to monoclonal antibodies. So the drug is daratumumab, Darzalex. This is anti-CD38 antibody, and you know that CD38 is always present on plasma cells. This is a game changer, a real game changer. It works through different mechanisms, so it's not just direct apoptosis. It works through ADCC, CDC, and ADCP as well. So this has got a remarkable activity as a single agent as well as in combination in relapse setting. So that's great, isn't it? Dara-based combinations are today preferred in the first relapse. Not only that, the drug is under study upfront in first-line therapy, and the limited data shows that it has ability to reverse the cardiac and renal dysfunction. So this is a publication. Dara for relapsed refractory AL amyloid with high plasma cell burden. And these are the responses. This blue is complete response. Look at this blue. The purple is very good partial response. And no response is just over here. This is another publication. Blue is CR. Green is VGPR. Yellow is PR. And red is stabilized disease. So fantastic, isn't it? And this is the depth of response. So much so that Blood Journal, the Bible of Hematology, publishes a commentary. AL amyloidosis patients don't dare go without Dara. So if you're trying to treat amyloid without Dara, you really have to. Venetoclax, the BCL2 inhibitor. So we discussed that AL amyloid 11-14 is present in every alternate patient. So there are studies showing that when venetoclax is combined with Cyborg D, it converted the partial responses into complete responses. Venetoclax with Dex in relapse setting is under trial at the moment. This is venetoclax in light chain amyloidosis. This is venetoclax inducing complete response in light chain amyloidosis in a patient who was on Cyborg D. Moving on, there are certain novel anti-amyloid treatments. And what do these novel anti-amyloid treatments do? Up to now, we were talking about methods of reducing the production of amyloid. These are drugs which remove amyloid from the organs. None of these are approved, except for this age-old doxycycline, an antibiotic which you use for various infections. All others are still research tool. They all probably will receive orphan drug status. Some of them, the research has already stopped because of either ineffectivity or toxicity. So this is our complete therapeutic armamentarium in 2020. So your novel agents, venetoclax, your steroid, prednisolone, dexamethasone, alkylating agent, melphalan, IV melphalan for transplant, cyclophosphamide, bendamustine, your three IMIDs, you've got at least three proteasome inhibitors, and you've got monoclonal antibody. Bone marrow transplant. Bone marrow transplant in amyloid is autologous transplant. In every patient that enters your clinic, your first step is to look for whether the patient is eligible for autologous transplant. What are the eligibility criteria? Younger patient, drop T, good. Systolic blood pressure, good. Kidney, good. Performance status, good. NYHF functional status, good. No large pleural effusion. Not dependent on oxygen therapy. And if there is organ involvement, then there should be no significant organ involvement more than two. So if you take these four, more than two, that is three, should not be known. Unfortunately, most of AL amyloid patients are not eligible for autologous transplant, especially in a country like India and also in the Western world, because diagnosis is late. It is missed. So they do not fulfill the eligibility criteria. So though somebody will start discussion on management of AL amyloid with transplant, I put it at the end because most of the time you are not able to advise transplant. If you try to do that, there can be significant mortality. But if you exclude Mayo stage 3-4, and if you have excellent support structure and good experience, then 100-day mortality can be dropped to, look at this, 1%. So transplant is possible in carefully selected patients with excellent supportive care and with the experienced team. And this is what happens if you are able to do the transplant, wonders of wonders. The blue is the median overall survival, the green is the progression-free survival. And look at it where you are, 60 months to 80 months. Interestingly, in myeloma, you do autologous transplant after 4 months or 6 months of treatment. Interestingly, this kind of induction therapy can be bypassed when it is amyloid. So in Mayo Clinic, if the marrow plasma cells are less than 10%, so that you are classical primary amyloid, they transplant directly without giving any preceding induction therapy. The median overall survival of transplanted patient Mayo Clinic was 10 years. Phenomenal. Overall, the ASCT related mortality was 12%. This is overall. And the median time to relapse was 4 years. And of course, you can keep treating. So overall, 10 years. What about other organ transplant? Amyloid can damage kidney, amyloid can damage heart, amyloid can damage liver. So there are small studies showing that you can do cardiac transplant, kidney transplant, liver transplant. Most of the patients present in advanced stage, so they are not candidate for this kind of allogeneic grafting. there are some small number of patients where cardiac transplant followed by bone marrow transplant have been reported. In patients who have undergone heart transplant, there's 18% transplant-related mortality. 1 year survival was 82, 5 year survival was 65%. Similarly, renal transplants can be considered. These are the results of renal transplant as per response of amyloid to your drug therapy. So first of all, renal transplant are becoming more and more popular. 1990s, around 2000, around 2010, they're becoming more. And if you achieve CR or VGPR with your medical treatment, then the success of transplants is much better than if you get PR and NR. Similarly, those patients who had CR and VGPR, recurrences were less than if you did in the patient had PR and NR. This is a publication, long-term outcome of kidney transplant in AL amyloid. So it's all possible and it's all being done. So treatment of amyloid is like a jigsaw puzzle. You put everything together, support therapy, nutrition, involvement of cardiologists to take care of bradyarrhythmia, tachyarrhythmia, atrial fibrillation, cardiac support, kidney support, and then various kind of anti-amyloid drugs and the transplant and specific organ transplant. When you do all this treatment, you have to be careful whether your patient is responding or you are giving a treatment which is not working. So how do you do that? So you have organ transplant criteria, organ response criteria, I'm sorry. So cardiac response, there should be 30% drop in NT-proBNP. Renal response, there should be 50% drop in proteinuria. Liver response, there should be 50% drop in alkaline phosphatase or liver size coming down by 2 cm on imaging. And neurology assessment is usually not done because EMG does not show many changes. Then there are hematological response criteria in which you look at DFLC. So no response, partial response when DFLC goes down by 50%, VGPR when it becomes less than 40 mg per L, and complete response when FLC ratio becomes normal and immunofixations in the serum and urine become normal. So this is hematological response criteria. And look at survival as per hematological response. So you achieve CR, look at this, 90% of survival at the end of 4 years. And if you didn't achieve any response, then survival is just about 1.5 years. You can assess minimal residual disease. So though the plasma cell number is very small, but if you have got FISH abnormalities, if you have got flow abnormalities, you know that there is monoclonality, you can look at all those to assess the minimal residual disease. And this is correlation of minimal residual disease, MRD, with organ response. So if your MRD was negative, organ response is superior to if MRD was positive. This applies to kidney, heart, and any other organ response. This is published by Boston Group. Unfortunately, in real world, AL amyloid overall survival is like this. So median survival is just over here. And therefore, if you diagnose a patient of AL amyloid, join hands with the centers doing clinical trial, clinical trial, clinical trial, clinical trial, clinical trial, clinical trial, clinical trial. So only if your patient is not fit for clinical trial or you do not have an access to clinical trial that you should give the standard treatment which we discussed so far. We have a long way to go. And the only way is to feed patients into clinical trials. I conclude my talk by saying it's extremely important to diagnose AL amyloid early. And this kind of early diagnosis cannot be overemphasized. Even in US and Europe, late diagnosis occurs in 1/3 of the patient. And by the time the patients are diagnosed, there's irreversible advanced organ damage. And these patients die within few months. And therefore, amyloidosis is still a silent killer in Australia, in Europe, in US. Patients in whom the diagnosis is made before irreversible organ damage occur, they do the best. Eligibility for autologous transplant should be assessed in all the patients and find out a person who is fit and then do it. PIs is the most important, commonest addition to an alkylating agent and steroid. So, Cyborg-D is the very popular regimen. And to that, sooner or later, you will be adding monoclonals or you may be adding venetoclax. Today, both these drugs are for relapsed patients. Response assessment must be practiced and don't keep giving a wrong treatment for a long time. I will be closing after introducing you to certain centers of excellence. So Boston, I'm repeatedly talking about this because my friend works there, Boston University School of Medicine, and that's the amyloid group. And that's my friend here, Dr. Vaishali Sanchurawala. Another friend from Nagpur, Dr. Ashutosh Vachalekar, heads the National Amyloid Center, University College London, Royal Free Campus in London. And he's the one who is the owner of the only SAP scan in the world. And he's a very good friend. He obliges you by processing your samples for mass spectroscopy to give you the type of amyloid. And then another friend, Maury Gertz from Mayo Clinic, Rochester, Minnesota. Dedicated man for amyloid, Mayo Clinic, hematologist, oncologist, chair, internal medicine, division of hematology, Maury Gertz, Mayo Clinic, Rochester. And above all, the father of amyloid, Robert Kyle. Robert Kyle joined Mayo Clinic in 1930s. I'm not telling you something wrong, 1930s. The man is today going to have a life in century. He's going to touch 100 years of age. He walks, he attends conferences, and he talks. He is real father. Well, thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to speak to you on my subject of AL amyloidosis. Before I take up questions, I would like to welcome you to our Sunday pre-lunch webinars. And this Sunday, we are discussing kidney in myeloma with this faculty, which is everyone is who is who. And also a day earlier, Saturday evening, Dr. Manali Kamdar from US on practice changing advances in lymphoma during 2019-2020. All 180 of you who have been logged in today, we will send you the information. You can register for these two. These two require pre-registration, which is complimentary, and then you will get the link for attending. Now we go to the questions.
Yeah, sir. I would like to ask participants to type the questions in Q&A box. Is there? Sir, you have questions in box. So
I've opened the questions now. So the first question over here is, what was the kidney mass biopsy in case 2? Okay, so that's kidney mass biopsy was incidental. It was a benign tumor. It was what is called angiolipomyoma, if I pronounce the word correctly. It's a fat tumor which has rich vascular supply. The only problem with that can be that it's vascular, so it bleeds. You remember? He bled. That was a combination of a vascular benign tumor with, it's a hamartoma, where amyloid led to more bleeding. The second question is by Dr. Anjum Kumar Ramavat. There is a huge rain and power cut in my area. Can I get the recorded link? So my friend, I think RPG has a video made.
Yes, sir. Yeah. We are going to provide the video link very soon.
The video. Anonymous person has asked, sir, how to treat such a patient who has MGUS with nephrotic range proteinuria with AA type of amyloid on kidney biopsy. So MGUS, you only follow up. It could be low risk MGUS or high risk MGUS, depending upon that you follow up the patient. Now, obviously, if you've got AA amyloid, that MGUS is incidental. So now you come to the nephrotic rich proteinuria due to AA amyloid. AA amyloid is secondary amyloid. AA amyloid is a reactive amyloid. So you're looking at the basic disease. So first, to arrest the disease, you have to find out that disease. Tuberculosis, bronchiectasis, rheumatoid arthritis, something else. And treat that aggressively so that further damage to the kidney, further amyloidogenic protein is not produced. We do not have specific drug against AA amyloid. The most important thing is not to use anti-plasma drugs here. Dr. Abha Dubey from Mumbai. Coexistence of amyloid and multiple myeloma, incidence and any special consideration in terms of treatment. Yes, Abha, about 10% of patients of multiple myeloma have amyloidosis during the course of their life. So this Sunday, if you are joining, you're going to listen about the amyloid myeloma kidney. And one of the five important causes is amyloid. Overall, 10% of patients develop amyloidosis, not necessarily of kidney, but any organ. And those 10%, besides the specific treatment of amyloid myeloma, which we just discussed, you'll have to take care of amyloid in the sense cardiac, and cardiac. Myeloma, hardly ever we talk about heart. We talk about kidney, we talk about marrow, we talk about anemia, we talk about bones. But the moment there's amyloid, you're looking at the heart. You're looking at the peripheral neuropathy. You're looking at autonomic neuropathy. All those things. Abha has another question. Is TSH done because of the possible organ involvement? Yes. Cancer care by Dr. Bharat Patodia. The question is there a role of maintenance in transplant ineligible patient? Yes, so we talked about maintenance. So we didn't have very good drugs for maintenance. As I told you, when melphalan was used, it led to myelodysplasia. So the dictum today is not to use beyond 1 year. Most of the IMIDs are not the preferred drugs. Thal because of peripheral neuropathy, Len because of cardiac toxicity, and POM is relatively a new drug. Most of the PI till now were injectable, and in India all are injectable. But now on the horizon, in the world, you have ixazomib, which is an oral PI. And that has been used for maintenance. And that has given great results. So ixazomib, which is a weak PI for myeloma, is a good PI for even maintenance therapy. So your Cybody endoxan can be linked with ixazomib, or you can have all oral preparation like ixazomib with Len and Dex, and then you can follow it with ixa. Cancer care, Bharat Patodi, another question is, which drug to prefer except melphalan? So you have three alkylating agents. So melphalan is today only for, as I said, my patients from Dharavi. So cyclophosphamide has become the standard of care, Cybody. And I showed you the data on bendamustine in relapsed patient. So alkylating agents, you've got three of them. And melphalan today is used basically for autologous transplant. Dr. Mittal Abhinil, does management depend upon Mayo stage induction versus direct transplant? In which patient in your practice do you prefer ASCT upfront versus PI induction? So first of all, there's a huge number of patients who are transplant ineligible. I mean, unfortunately, in India, that number is huge. So once they're transplant ineligible, it's all induction. Now, if they're transplant eligible and they have made up their mind, and if they don't fall in Mayo, you remember stage 3-4, that means they're transplant fit. Then you can go for transplant directly. You don't have to bother about induction therapy. The results appear that they are, the outcome is as good. Unlike in myeloma, where you reduce the disease burden. So next one is Sajin Raj Bhandari. Post ASCT, what would be your drug for maintenance therapy? So that's an interesting question. In India, you are left with very few options. Ixazomib is still a relatively new option. So maintenance therapy over here is very often still lenalidomide if cardiac toxicity is not there. I have started using pomalidomide. You have an access to it. It's generic and it is cost effective and free from the Len-induced cardiac problem. And it is also safe if there is a kidney problem. So I have now a good number of patients with pomalidomide. Ixazomib I still do not have an access to. Dr. Mittal Abhinil, in organ transplant versus ASCT, which one do you first? So for most of the condition organ transplant, you require a patient who is relatively fit. And the fitness comes from deep response to your amyloid treatment. Also, if your amyloid treatment is ineffective, you do not want to do a strong treatment like other organ transplant. So the one which is most popular is kidney transplant. Hardly any patient we have subjected to cardiac transplant in India. And I can only recruit one patient for liver transplant. Basically, we are talking about kidney transplant. So treatment of amyloid using various induction regime, autologous transplant, etc., invariably has a precedence over renal transplant. The next one is from again Dr. Bharat Patodia. After induction chemo, if transplant is delayed, then should you observe or continue maintenance? Yeah, you can continue maintenance, and you have written about bortezomib, fair enough. Abha Dubey did not understand regarding no induction therapy in stem cell transplant for amyloid. Wouldn't the clone, however minute it might be, continue to secrete amyloid protein? Okay. So you basically believe that autologous transplant is manifold more effective treatment than just the anti-plasma cell drug therapy. So that's the basic principle, that if possible, if patient is transplant fit and in Indian circumstances can afford an access to a good center experienced in amyloid transplant, your primary treatment is transplant. Therefore, if you read about treatment of amyloidosis, you will discuss ASCT above anti-plasma drugs. So anti-plasma drugs are used only if your patient is transplant ineligible or he has to wait for the transplant. No amount of treatment of amyloidosis is a cure. So I agree with you that even if the MRD is negative, the clone remains there. So we are not talking of cure. We are talking of a very long survival and a good quality survival, which an autologous transplant gives. Dr. Mittal, again, in your experience, is tolerance to lenalidomide in amyloid patient poor as compared to myeloma? Usually starting dose of 15 to 25 milligram. So I have used lenalidomide good amount till POM became available, and I have used small dose. I have used 10 milligram and very carefully, because you are concerned about the cardiac toxicity of IMiDs in this patient. So there are patients where heart is good, so then you're not scared, you will go 15-25 as well. But most of the patients, the heart is not good. In fact, they have been diagnosed by a cardiologist, suspected by a cardiologist. Most of the patients come to us by cardiologist or nephrologist. So when the heart is involved, we are a bit concerned about using thalidomide and lenalidomide. SAP scan specific, not for heart. So SAP scan is diagnostic because it is by using an antibody against SAP protein. So it is specific. Specificity is not challenged, but somehow it does not pick up cardiac involvement. So if it's negative, it doesn't mean anything for the heart. So you can neither diagnose heart involvement nor you can follow up these patients. And you can do that beautifully, as I showed you in the picture, for liver, spleen, and kidney. Amarnath Deshpande. Good evening, Dr. Deshpande. Amyloid score. So that's in the kidney biopsy, the two types of score that I told you. If you attend this Sunday, you will hear about it. We've got two histopathologists talking about amyloid to us. Mona Vijayan. ISC facility for subtyping the amyloid is not available. What should be done? Well, that's unfortunate. So you have this, you know, in Bombay, we are fortunate that we've got these two nephropathologists, deep interest in kidney pathology. And then they have developed ISC. For example, antibody against kappa lambda, I think it's widely available in the country. Yes, antibody against AA and ATTR, some centers will have it, majority will not have it. But this can be done on the transported paraffin blocks, so you should not have a problem. We even send tissue to, again, Vachalekar, and they all oblige. They don't charge you. They all oblige you. They are our Indian friends, internationally placed in best centers. Dr. Parmod Kumar, role of imaging for organomegaly in MGUS to pick up AL amyloid. So yes, I mean, AL amyloid to pick up, the imaging is very, very popular. For example, when you suspect heart, you go beyond echo and you do an MRI. It's standard of care. We don't do PET scan very regularly for the heart, but MRI is a standard of care. Similarly, doing imaging for other organs. Role of echo, yes, of course. Echo is done left and right. So whether the clinical picture is suggestive or not, ECG suggests, echo is done for everybody. And in many patients, the cardiologist is so confident that he says, you can go ahead with the abdominal pad fat biopsy. Echo is strongly suggestive. I don't even need MRI. You save a lot of money. Miranda Astrid, prognosis in AA and ATTR. So AA is the prognosis of the basic disease. And when have you See, overall in amyloid, it depends upon when have you diagnosed the patient. Which organ is involved? How much organ is involved? Late diagnosis, organ is badly damaged, the outcome is poor. AA, you do not have a specific drug. You control the basic disease. In ATTR, there are now specific drugs. There are at least four drugs. None of them are yet available to India. Someday we'll discuss that, but yes, treatment of even diagnosis of ATTR in India is a problem. And as I mentioned, the senile type of ATTR, the one with the wild type, is said to be missed and quite common. And therefore, this percentage which I showed you is because it is missed all across the world. Amarnath Deshpande, I don't get your question. It's written post-organ amyloid. I'm not very clear. Post-organ amyloid. I'm sorry.
I think post-organ transplant amyloid.
Post-organ transplant amyloid. So, yes, transplanted organs, if the basic disease has not responded well, can get amyloid again. So that is a failure of transplant. So you don't do kidney transplant if your basic disease, amyloid has not responded to treatment or very partially responded to the treatment. I hope that was your question. Nagavalli T. Bortezomib was given to MGUS of a patient with nephrotic range proteinuria. Can you please further elaborate? So, I'm not sure what we are talking about, but if it was really MGUS, then you don't give bortezomib. So, I presume that the nephrotic range proteinuria was finally shown to be a part of AL amyloidosis. So, maybe your patient had what is called monochrome gammopathy of renal significance, or your patient had amyloidosis. So if these things are there, then you use bortezomib. So overall, bortezomib will be used if you are blaming the light chain in some form causing nephrotic syndrome. And you have documented that. I agree that in India, very often, we may not have an access to mass spectro, or you may not have an access to immunohistochemistry. So if you have documented a light chain in the kidney by IC, that's good enough. And that's what we do mostly. We insist on our nephropathologist that we are suspecting, look for the light chain. And then they document by antibodies and fluorescence that there is pure kappa, pure lambda in the kidney, which is sufficient to accept the diagnosis and start the treatment. Miranda, amyloid versus myeloma kidney. So myeloma kidney is common. I come on this Sunday and here to our webinar. 50% of patients of myeloma at initial presentation have impaired creatinine clearance. 20% of patients have serious kidney disease characterized by raised creatinine not amounting to dialysis. 10% of patients of myeloma are dialysis dependent at clinical presentation. Now, 10% of myeloma kidney is for light chain, so that's different. So let's say myeloma associated kidney, 10% is due to amyloid. And in amyloidosis, 65% of patients can develop AL amyloid, 65% of patients can develop kidney problem. Okay? So amyloid kidney is nephrotic syndrome, myeloma kidney is light casket. I'm going with semantics. Anonymous, is there any change in treatment in rheumatic disorders induce amyloid? So that becomes AA amyloid. So there's a total change In AA amyloid, you cannot use the drug therapy which we use for against plasma cells. So here you control the rheumatic or rheumatoid disorder to control the further progress of amyloid. Chitra Madiwale, good evening, welcome. We've been talking about you all through. I'm telling people to come on Sunday to listen to you. Any comments on AH amyloid? So I will ask you to answer this on Sunday. I do not know how common it is in your practice, but you must be looking for them in all your kidneys, and I'm sure you will tell us something more about it on Sunday. So she's our faculty for Sunday for kidney in myeloma. Dina Dayalan, role of doxies. Okay, so I had almost 10 slides, but I removed all of them. First of all, this is not for AL amyloid. So it has been used for other amyloid, like AA amyloid and ATTR amyloid. Simple drug, cost nothing, 100 milligram given by mouth. But you know, I put it in the orphan category because still the world is not convinced that there is a major change in duration of life or the quality of life. But there is a documentation that doxy decreases the amyloidogenic protein in the organs in those cases. It is not for AL amyloid. Okay. Kavita Sachdev, do you have a recording available? Yes, RPG has got a video made. They will send it to you. Amit Khurana from Surat, my friend, yes. M protein, 1.5 gram on electrophoresis. Bone marrow, plasma cells, 5%. Okay. Kidney biopsy shows AL amyloid. Whether to consider it MGRS or whether to consider that AL amyloid. So, you know, MGRS, the term got coined in 2012, 8 years. So by definition, it excludes diseases which are well established. So if you got a well established AL amyloid because you got a clonal plasma cell population, you got a M band of 1.5 grams, I will not call it MGRS. What is MGRS? MGRS is when there is no myeloma. MGRS is when you have documented that there is monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, fulfilling those criteria, and there is some sort of kidney involvement. So say tomorrow Dr. Chitra shows that yes, kidney disease is due to 1, 2, 3, 4, and I show that there is MGUS. Until yesterday I would have said patient needs no treatment, but today I will say this patient needs treatment because though this is not myeloma, though this is not amyloid, though this is not light chain deposition disease, but there is a kidney damage taking place due to this so-called little change. But this is not that little change. Similarly, M protein 1.5, the next question is, similarly M protein 1.5 gram, 2% clonal plasma cells, AL amyloid on nerve biopsy. So will you call it monoclonal gammopathy of neurological significance? Or will you call it AL amyloid? So once you document amyloid in the nerve biopsy, I will call it amyloid. Once you document amyloid in the kidney, I will call it amyloid. So all these are new diseases where there is no standard disease like amyloidosis or myeloma or light chain deposition or heavy chain deposition or immunoglobulin deposition. So those things, standard things should not be there. So these terms will be used only for patients who yesterday would have been called MGUS, MGUS, MGUS. So MGUS has got neuropathy, and you could prove that that neuropathy is due to the light chain or, as Chitra asked, heavy chain. Then you call it off, the two are connected. So the connection has to be documented. Say a diabetic person has got MGUS. So you say this is diabetic kidney, but the biopsy shows that there is a light or heavy chain responsible for this, then it becomes monoclonal gammopathy of renal significance. And the kidney pathology, of course, in MGRS or in nerve pathology. Nerve pathology is not well studied, mind you. This nerve biopsy, what you have mentioned, is not done left and right, not like kidney biopsy. But if you have done it and if you have shown some disease and you can document it connected, then for example, our patient was treated as CIDP. He will not be treated as CIDP because he did a nerve biopsy and showed light chain deposition. There's a nice discussion by none other than Vincent Rajkumar, that this has opened up a Pandora's box. What question you ask is opened up a Pandora's box, because you've got peripheral neuropathy in dozens and you've got MGUS in dozens. Now you keep talking about correlating the two and you hardly find patients where really the two are connected. Okay. Kavita Sachdev, send us the link to record, link to recording by mail. I suppose RPG will give you everything. Abdullah Mosabhai, is there any role of maintenance in AL amyloid? So maintenance is relatively a new concept in AL amyloid. It sort of got discussed in a big way because of the 6 years of ixazomib approval. And of course, you have been using it in past, as somebody had asked, with IMiDs in India, pomalidomide recently, lenalidomide in past. I don't think many use bortezomib. One question was bortezomib, but bortezomib causes peripheral neuropathy and amyloid causes peripheral neuropathy, not very popular. So options, okay, options I already told you. If you have an access to ixazomib, will be the best. Pomalidomide, in my mind, will be the second best. Len will be the third drug. Borte and Thal, I will be scared of using. I will not use melphalan because it can cause myelodysplastic syndrome. Duration will be till you find that it has stopped working. You find a relapse of amyloid by any organ, you will stop using it. My friend Suprakash Sanyal, Fortis Hospital, Mumbai. POM and DEX, please share your personal experience. So I'm very comfortable with POM. I'm using POM as a first line therapy in myeloma and amyloid patients. So this is my preferred IMiD for various reasons. Once it is generic, has become available and the cost is no concern, this has become my preferred. So I have used it left and right. Mittal Abhinil, dose of melphalan in ASCT, 140-200. So the kidney is not bad, 140, the kidney is not bad, 200, kidney is bad, 140. Subhaprakash Sanyal is the right person to answer this question. He does all this. So Suprakash Sanyal has put a question. In case of severe neuropathy, what will be your first line of therapy? What I will not use is bortezomib. What I will not use is thalidomide. Rest is all up to you. So you can use drugs like all alkylating agents. You can use all steroids. You can use modern IMiDs like pomalidomide. If I am very fond of daratumumab, I'm not recommending because most of Indian patients cannot afford this. But Dara is fantastic. And if you've got 1114, you can try venetoclax. These are all off the shelf. These are not approved drugs. But yes, except bortezomib and thalidomide, you have all the ocean of drugs. Galaxy, question is, can ACE herb be used in renal myeloma? Because of nephrotic range proteinuria, this, it can change the prognosis and course of disease. Well, I suppose so. There should be, except that if you've got amyloidosis and if you've got sort of involvement of the organs, which of course your patient has, you have to use them carefully in low dose. But of course, yes, sure. Mona, bladder amyloidosis, drugs to be used. So you have to document that this is not a localized amyloidosis. Bladder is not the common site of amyloid. So if you've got a patient of amyloidosis of bladder or one organ, then first you say this is systemic amyloid or local amyloid. If it is systemic amyloid, AL amyloid, then we've discussed today. AA amyloid, you go to the basic disease and control the disease. And ATTR, then those four new molecules which have come up, if your patient has an access to that. Sajid Rajbhandari, thank you, sir. Okay, that's a comment. Tathagat Chatterjee, good evening, Tathagat. Very nice to see that you are logged in. Any relation with AGRS and AL amyloid? As we just discussed, that if you have AL amyloid, you are not talking about MGRS. So MGRS terminology will be used in a patient where there is MGUS and there is involvement of an organ, not by the well-defined entities. And then you show that the monoclonal protein, light chain, heavy chain, is the responsible cause of that organ involvement. Like Chitra documenting that there is light chain in the kidney or heavy chain in the kidney, and she'll tell you all sorts of pathology that can happen in MGRS. Lalit Mohan Sharma from Jaipur. Excellent talk. Thank you so much, Lalit. It is mentioned that amyloid may be responsible for Alzheimer's disease and age-related ocular problem. Do you have practical experience and can you guide us? So this is not exactly what is meant by senile amyloidosis. People who are doing research on Alzheimer's disease and age-related other amyloid disorders have documented that amyloid is there in the brain tissue in Alzheimer's. All sorts of trials took place in last one decade to show whether controlling amyloid improved the prognosis of Alzheimer's. And there's a huge disappointment. So yes, there is amyloid in the brain tissue in Alzheimer, but it doesn't respond to any treatment. Subha Prakash Sanyal again, how do you use bendamustine in your practice? I would like to know what protocol and exit. So blood has given those protocols. Bendamustine has been used in a relapse patient internationally. It has not been used upfront. Upfront, you use cyclophosphamide if you are using alkylating agent, and for a poor person, even melphalan. So bendamustine, if you are using, you will have to be a little careful, but anywhere between 70 to 90 milligram per meter square, 2 days consecutive, should be reasonable dose. Unlike myeloma, the marrow function in amyloid is reasonably well preserved. So you can take liberty of full dose of bendamustine. Anonymous, a 65-year-old male, nephrotic range proteinuria, creatinine 2.2, electrophoresis showed M protein, marrow shows 15% plasma cells, lambda 88, kappa 24. Shall I do kidney biopsy to rule out amyloid? So a researcher will do that. For me, it's not very important that I do kidney biopsy. The case is ready-made, plasma cell of 15%. It's in the range of more of myeloma than just amyloid. And there is already nephrotic range proteinuria. This patient will need same treatment, whether I document amyloid, whether I document light chain deposition disease. If it is lambda, it will be more like amyloid. If it is kappa, it will be more like lambda. I think as a clinician, it is not very important for me. And my nephrologist colleague, if I call them also, they said, why do you want to do it? He may lose his kidney. And I know all VIPs, they go without kidney biopsy. In AA wild type, this is wrong terminology. Wild type and mutated type is ATTR. AA, there is no WT. So AA amyloid protein can be detected through FLC assay? No. If FLC assay is abnormal, unless it's just an incidental finding, then you'll think more like AL amyloid. So you can have a chance incidence of, which is very common, that an elderly person got AA amyloid due to a rheumatoid and he's got an MGUS. So that can happen. Last question, I suppose. Dr. Rajat Bajaj. Good evening, Dr. Rajat Bajaj. In your experience, what's the maximum survival of patient with AL amyloid? What do you counsel the patient about the median survival? So, unfortunately, majority of our patients are very late cases. Median survival, if you take of all my patients, will be somewhere between 1.5 to 2 years. But at the same time, if you talk about this maximum survival, then I'm quite lucky. I've got patients entered second decade of life with amyloid. So, a lot of credit goes to a lot of drugs that have become available. Last 3 years, I've used Vendara. This year, I'm using venetoclax. And earlier, we have used Cybody, plenty, autologous transplants. And maybe some of our these private hospitals are diagnosing this disease early. So that's the last question. So thank you very much. Hand over to RPG.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for sharing your experience with us in this unique and enriching session. We had close to 40 questions. It was a marathon session for us. So, sir, thank you for attending that too and sharing your views. For all the respected doctors who are attending this session, we will provide you the YouTube link for this session after due permission from Agarwal, sir, and his approval. We will share it soon. Thank you. Thank you for your request and question. Sir, any concluding remark from your side?
Including remark is that if you have spent your 2 hours listening to AL amyloid, try your best to diagnose these cases early. All your colleagues in the field of cardiology, neurology, nephrology, and gastroenterology. Make friendship with them. Tell them which case of theirs. See, you will not get a case if majority of the crowd is hematology and hematology student. You will not get a ready case with you. These cases have to come to you by nephrologist, cardiologist, neurologist, and gastroenterologist. So they have to have a very high index of suspicion. And they have to order for tests like serum-free light chain assay beyond electrophoresis. And once those tests are ordered, they should be very liberal with abdominal fat pad biopsy. In your institute, one surgeon should have the technique of doing it. And then you should have a pathologist like Dr. Chitra, who has taken pains to attend this particular seminar. So you should have access to a very good nephropathologist. And then you are the boss. Treat patient aggressively. Treat patient within his budget. Give the best possible treatment. Autologous transplant, DARA, venetoclax are okay for talking. When it comes to a simple Indian patient, it will be cyclophosphamide, melphalan, prednisolone, bortezomib, and maybe a drug like pomalidomide. So early diagnosis, liberal use of investigations, liberal use of abdominal pad fat biopsy, educating your other colleagues, and then take over the case and treat the patient as best as possible. That's the message.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for giving us your valuable time in guiding the medical fraternity for such a complex subject. We will be eagerly waiting for you, sir, for such interesting session in future also. Till then, on the behalf of RPG Life Science and to all the doctors, we bid goodbye. Thanks a lot. Take care.
Thank you. Good night.